good? Okay. Hello, and welcome to the Tisbury Council on Aging. I'm delighted to be back. My name is Arthur Bergeron. For those of you who haven't seen me, I do elder law. I'm an attorney at a firm called Myrick O'Connell. There are 60 of us. I'm the elder law guy. So I love being there because I don't have to think about anything else. I just do this. And we've been doing these presentations now. I was just talking to Jackie Cage about it for, I think, like 8 years, always sponsored here by Joyce. And Joyce has been wonderful about that over a lot of years. So the purpose of this presentation is to, I always tell people, you know, people say, what does an elder law lawyer do exactly? But one of the things I do, and that we need to do, is to just to kind of connect you with people, to have you understand the people that you need to know as you're getting older. And there are a couple of essential players that you need to know. Because you need to know, who do you call if there's an issue? But the last thing you need to be doing is, when there's an emergency, trying to figure out who do you call. So the goal of the exercise is to say, hey, you're retired, you got time on your hands. This is a good time to go find out, like, who you're supposed to be calling. So as for many of you know, my friends Frank and Mary, the couple that I always talk about, and they remind people a lot of themselves, is my friends here, Frank and Mary, and their children, Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. And as I always tell people, if you get that joke, that means you can be my client, because you're old enough that you think that's funny. So, and their goal is, they're going to live in their house until they die, and they want to be buried in the backyard. Ideally, if one of them dies, they want to make sure the other one is safe. And when they're both died, they want to get things divided up among the kids, except in Martha's Vineyard, where oftentimes they're trying to figure out what to do with the house. Because in the rest of the universe, people sell the house and divide up the money. But nobody ever wants to sell a house, it seems, in Martha's Vineyard. But that's a separate topic. We've done that presentation. So that's their situation. They have a modest home for Martha's Vineyard, $300,000. Frank has an IRA of $150. They have an annuity worth $100. They've got bank accounts worth $75. Their total assets are worth $625,000. Frank has income from Social Security of $1,500 a month, and Mary of $750. And Frank also has a pension of $500 a month. So their income every month is $2,750. So they're making around $30,000 a year. So they're okay. They're doing okay. But their questions, though, are, well, first of all, why in the world would I want to go to the senior center? I'm not old. And kind of the answer to that is, well, you know, first of all, let me tell you are old. I mean, I'm 65. I've had to suck it up. I'm old, you know. And the senior center is a place where you can just find out just an incredible amount of stuff. The senior center is regarded at the state and federal level as kind of the first window through which you can kind of see what your programs you might be eligible for. And so my friend Joyce Stiles Tucker has been kind enough to talk a little bit about what happens at the senior center and what kinds of programs they offer and what kinds of advice you might want to be talking to. Then my friend Jackie Cage from Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands is going to talk to you about Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands. They are the people that Frank and Mary need in order to stay at home. And we're just like nurses and social workers who have decided to really be interested in this area and concentrate on helping people who are older figure out how in the world to navigate through all the various agencies and things and figure out the programs that they want and the services they need in order to stay at home. They are the people that Frank and Mary need in order to stay at home. And we're just lucky that I think that Sandy is here. I deal with these folks a lot back in America. And she's really one of the best of the geriatric care managers that I've ever met. I actually have her come back to the United States sometimes to do presentations with us on how they do it in the islands, you know. So I'd like to start off by asking Joyce to come up and talk to us a little bit about the Council on Aging and about kind of what they do and stuff, whatever Joyce wants to talk about. Joyce. Remember? I mean, so here's my high-tech lesson. That's forward, that's back. That's all I know.
That's all I know.
All right.
Thank you. As Arthur mentioned, one of the focal points in our community is our senior center, / Council on Aging. We provide a wide variety of programs and services that one can participate in. We are here 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, and 8:30 to 4:30, and what we have various programs throughout the day.
That's
that,
very good. You got that. You did.
That we do have, and I had to chuckle when Arthur said we're only for old people. Well, we're not. We have a lot of programs that, you know, we're not, we don't have wheelchairs. I mean, we do have a peer supportive day program here as well, but we don't sit around and just do, you know, nothing. We have a lot of different activities that one can take, knitting, we have play reading, we have, we go to the symphony, we have other day trips, we have lunch here every day. We do a lot of socialization. And so, having said that, we try to encourage people just to come by, just to, you know, see what we do. In addition to all to that, we do provide a lot of information and referral. We refer you to Elder Services or Horizons at Sandy for the services that they might be able to help you with. But the one thing that I want to stress, though, is we don't want you to wait until it's a crisis to get in touch with us. Come and see us before and see what we're about and see what other programs that are available. Because when you get into a crisis situation, it's you know, everybody's, you know, a little disheveled. We provide advocacy. We do have a companion, elder companion, that helps people with their shopping and provide respite.
Is that a volunteer? Are those volunteers?
No, this person is paid as part of the town. And we have, we call people in the morning to check in on them, make sure that they're okay.
Joyce, is this the only town that does that? Do you know?
No, every town does.
Really?
This, I believe.
So that's really a service of the Council on Aging.
Yeah,
that's
great. These are things that we provide. We have a health screening each month. We have the town nurse come and do blood pressure screening. And there's another day that she comes and answers any questions that you have with medications and so forth. And we provide educational programs like this as well. We provide, the information that we do provide is home care services, which we may refer you to Jackie and Elder Services program. There are other hospice that we all provide, that provide services that if needed. Legal assistance, we have elder law lawyer that comes down and assists with any questions or any issues. We have health insurance assistance, we call it SHINE, which stands for Serving Insurance Needs of Everyone.
And that's coming right up, right? Medicare D time is just
about
time.
We have open enrollment, which starts in October and ends in December, and that's a busy time because that's the time where everyone who needs to change their coverage, Medicare secondary supplemental coverage, that happens. So it is a busy time. But
by the way, just a plug for you on that. So it's been my experience. Nobody knows more about Medicare D than the SHINE counselors on Aging. You know,
you get
flooded with all of these pitches about these different plans, right? But they've actually really got the information about all the plans.
Yes.
About all the plans. So you can really figure out, because once again, the most important thing about your Medicare D plan isn't necessarily the premium, it's are your drugs on the
covered.
List.
Yes.
So many people, they go for low premium, but it turns out their drugs aren't covered and they're paying $1 jillion as a result. But the SHINE counselor can really help you with that.
Yeah. And here we have a counselor available the second and the fourth Thursday of each month. So keep that in mind. We do have a support group, a diabetes support group that meets once a month. And there are other support groups that are out there too, a caregiver support group, Parkinson's support group. So there are various support groups out there. We do have a newsletter that comes out in the Martha's Vineyard Times each month. Matter of fact, it's one coming out this coming Thursday. Comes out the last Thursday of each month that has all of the programs and that are available at each Council on Aging. We have information on housing. We have island elderly housing. As you know, there's Hillside and Woodside. And Havenside apartments. And then we have two assisted living facilities, Henrietta Brewer House and Long Hill. And it's also an assisted living at Windermere as well. The one that I don't, that's not here, is the Greeno House. That's independent. They're independent apartments as well here in Tisbury. We provide information. Other programs that we certainly talk about as well is a lifeline, the medical alert. For those who are living alone, it's a good thing to have, you know, especially if they're susceptible to falling. You just press a button and help is on its way. There's another program called the Project Lifesaver, which is basically through the Sheriff's Department runs that program. And basically, if so you have a aging parent or loved one who wanders, it's like a GPS tracking system. Okay, they wear a bracelet, and if they wander off, they can be tracked. If you call them soon enough, they'll come and track the person. It's a really good program. The File of Life is also another program that we also make it available to everyone, and that's basically you list all of your medications so that if you do have to call an ambulance, the emergency personnel will know what your medications are, what your medical history is, and so forth. Now that leads me to Jackie, who is going to talk about health services.
Joyce, thank you so much. Thank you so much. And so once again, it's just a huge variety of programs that are available. But the main thing is they are the window through to so many of the programs, especially the ones that are provided by the ASAP, Jackie Cage. And I think I'm just parking you there.
You're going to park
right?
me there.
There.
There we are. So I don't get
Jackie
to push
says,
the button.
Don't make me use slides. She says, I don't want to use slides.
Okay. I'm Jackie Cage. I'm the Vineyard Director for Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands. And I'm very pleased to be here today and have this opportunity to speak to you all about what we at Elder Services do. We are a private nonprofit. It was formed as a grassroots organization in the early 70s. With the mission to promote the welfare of seniors, enhance their abilities as well as their safety, and of course maintain dignity. We are designated as the ASAP, which was the slide before. That's the Aging Service Access Point. We provide many of our programs through that designation. We're also the Area Agency on Aging, and in collaboration with CORD, which is CAPE Organization for the Rights of the Disabled, we are also something called an ADRC. What that means is that we have been able to develop a number of programs designed to enable us to assist elders in the community, as well as be true to our mission of for a long period of time. The Martha's Vineyard Office of Elder Services has been open on the island since 1976. We have a physical presence here. There are two care managers, a nurse, nutrition program coordinator, senior dining site manager, as well as an office manager right here on the island. And I'd encourage you to not only use this information for contacting us, but you can call us locally at 508-693-4393. And I've given you all a copy of our directory, and the back of it has all of that information, including the information regarding our local office here. What I'd like to do today is talk to you about some of our programs. The largest programs are our home care program and our nutrition program. The home care program is designed to assist older people to remain in their home, to provide supports for them as needed. And the way it works is a care manager will visit an elder at home. Their family can be present if the elder chooses.
And Jackie, could anybody just kind of call you to get someone to come?
Yes, if you would call, you can call our number, the 693-439 number, to get more information. All of our, to initiate an application and a home visit, you would call this number here. The 800 number.
And do you have to be really sick,
in
order to call?
No.
Because I think it's so important. People just assume that, I really can only call this if I'm really in bad shape.
No, it is. We are desirous of assisting people so that they can live comfortably through the day and perform the normal things we all do. Typically, what the care manager does is talk to them about their activities of the day and if there are things that they need support or actually someone else to do them for them. An average plan of care, which, you know, we developed the plan with the elder, but the average plan of care, it starts out very minimally. Typically, we are assisting some heavy housework with the shopping. We may find it necessary to purchase a personal emergency assistance response system. We may begin Meals on Wheels. Typically, we're not talking about medical services. We're talking about the type of assistance people need to do ordinary things that we all do every day. They're called activities of daily living, instrumental activities of daily living. The laundry has to get done. We need to be able to prepare meals. We need to be able to do our grocery shopping. So it is at that point that we would like to be able to initiate services to people. And the home care program itself, it is a state program, an elder needs to be 60. There are income guidelines for the program. However, there are no asset limits, and that's something that most people don't appear to.
There are no asset limits. So unlike Mass Health, where you have to be saying, I've only got, nothing left. You can have, my friends Frank and Mary, for example, the people that you saw that mm-hmm. have $625,000 in assets, right? That they could still call you regarding your program, depending on what their income is.
Yes, the eligibility is based on need for service and income. Of course, income derived from assets would be something that we would have to include in the application. But there is not an asset limit on this program. The home care program also can provide respite for caregivers. The elder would be enrolled in the home care program, and perhaps the service that is most needed is for their family member who's caring for them to have some respite. We would arrange for that either by having someone come into the home, or we can purchase services from Martha's Vineyard Center for Living Supportive Day Program. That is another piece of the home care program that's frequently overlooked. So I would encourage you, if you have any questions or concerns, or if you know people that might benefit from this as well, that you would encourage them to call. And we'd be more than happy to explain the program as well as take an application in their own home. The next program that most people have heard of is the nutrition program. The nutrition program has actually two components, Meals on Wheels, which is a meal delivered to the home every day. We deliver Monday through Friday, and we deliver frozen meals for the weekends. The other component, Joyce has already talked about a little. We have senior dining lunches at the Senior Center Monday through Friday, in Oak Bluffs on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and Up Island at the Up Island Council on Aging on Thursdays. And everyone on the island can go to any senior center. So we encourage people to participate as often and as frequently as they wish, not just limit themselves to the days that the service is provided in their particular senior center. The advantage of Meals on Wheels, obviously, is the meal is delivered at home, to the home, and of course it's delivered by a volunteer, and that person is also making a safety check. So every day, the individual will be getting a meal, and if they are not home or if there's some other concern, that is reported to us at our office, and we follow up on that to make sure people are safe. So those two programs, the nutrition program and the home care program, are our largest programs. But we have many other programs that I'd like to introduce to you if you have not already heard from about them. And excuse me just a second. We have a health services unit. It has two functions. A nurse, if we are in a home and it appears that the person needs assistance with bathing or other areas of personal care, the nurse will visit the house and do an assessment, a nursing assessment, arrange for safety equipment in the home if necessary, and actually write a care plan that will be followed for this person's personal care assistance. Additionally, and this is something that Arthur is quite familiar with, our nurse does the clinical assessments for Medicaid eligibility for MassHealth Standard Frail Elder Waiver, as well as payment for skilled nursing facility. So that is the role of our health services unit. We have a family caregiver support program that's designed to provide caregivers information as well as support in the effort to care for others. And interestingly, what normally gets forgotten here is as long as one of the individuals is over 60, they are eligible for this program. So while most often people think of a younger family member or friend caring for an elder, this program can also provide assistance to elders who might be providing care for grandchildren or a disabled child. So it is a service that is designed to provide not only information and referral, but support to people so that they can continue to provide the care that they wish to provide. We are also responsible for protective services, and we have a special unit, a protective services unit, that does investigate reports of abuse, neglect, financial exploitation, as well as self-neglect. And they will provide services to alleviate the harm if the report is confirmed. That is one of the few services that is provided directly from our main office in South Dennis. They provide staff members here on the island to do the investigations and, of course, to work with family if necessary afterwards. It's a skill that is highly trained and specific, and it is something that we feel works best with that level of skilled professionals as well as the skilled supervision. Additionally,
isn't this just unbelievable? I mean, people, the first time they hear this, they just can't believe. And by the way, the typical cost for these services is really close to zero. Right?
Almost all of them have no cost at all.
Just about everything she just talked about is free or almost free. So continue. I didn't mean to interrupt, but it's just always so amazing to people that it's true, you know.
In addition, as the Area Agency on Aging, we do provide some Older American Act community grants to local organizations. It's a competitive process. We ask for program proposals to meet needs here on the island as well as on the Cape. And there is an advisory board to Elder Services that reviews them, and grants are awarded annually. Current grant holders here on the Vineyard are Martha's Vineyard Community Services for their caregiver support program, Martha's Vineyard Center for Living for its program to provide medical transportation off island, the Healthy Aging Task Force, which is a part of the Dukes County Health Council for its training programs called Powerful Tools for Caregivers. It's an excellent program that's just started in the last year, and there's a session in place now. And of course, the legal services of South Shore received some funding from this source to provide the elder law attorney that is available by phone anytime, but visits the senior centers once a month. 1 month he's in Eggertown, the next month he's in Oak Bluffs, another month he's in Tisbury, and then of course the fourth month he's in Up Island. And since everyone can go to any senior center, if you have a problem that you want to discuss with him, you can make the phone call quickly and arrange to see him in whichever town he happens to be coming in next. In addition to the two grants to other agencies, we have a number of programs that have us interact very well with the agencies here on the island and services here on the island. You should note that our home care program, we don't actually provide the service with elder services staff other than the care management. We purchase services locally. So if someone needs housekeeping or personal care and maybe laundry service, we provide the service by creating a plan and then purchasing services from the V&A here, from the airport laundry, and perhaps from one of the house cleaning services here on the island. We have a program that visits Windermere regularly. It's called the Long-Term Care Ombudsman Program. Volunteers are trained to be very familiar with the policies and procedures of skilled nursing facilities, as well as mediation, so that they can serve as ombudsmen for patients and or their families if there are concerns while they are residents of the nursing home. This works very well for both the residents of Windermere, and it also is working well for Windermere itself. They are pleased to have our ombudsman visit their homes. They visit regularly, they visit unscheduled, and they can bring forth concerns before they become issues. So it's definitely a good thing for not only the patient and resident of the nursing home, but for the facility itself. We also provide a service called the Money Management Program. This program is also done with volunteers that are specifically trained and insured. They can offer an elder assistance in the mechanics of managing their household finances. The elder continues, of course, to make all their financial decisions, but this person assists with opening the bills, making sure they're clearly explained, perhaps doing some budgeting, writing checks, balancing checkbooks, the kinds of things that become difficult to do. We also have a senior service corps. This is a program that encourages volunteerism, and the way it works is we link with other organizations and assist them in finding volunteers, and also are able to support the volunteers in their efforts. The one that's most common here right now is Vineyard Village at Home. That's a nonprofit that, among other things, provides transportation to its members, and we are able to provide some modest reimbursement for mileage costs for the volunteers that are their volunteer drivers. So,
isn't that amazing?
I really am pleased to be here. I definitely think I've given you a long list of things. I did bring with me brochures that describe each of these programs separately and talks about not only what they provide, but how the service is provided, because that's always important. And it does give you some sense of any limitations to the service. I plan to be here after the presentations are over, and hope that if you have, you will help yourself to our brochures. And if you have any particular situations or concerns or questions that you'd like to talk to me directly about this evening, I certainly will be here. So,
Jackie, that's
thank you.
And how long have you been now at Island?
Oh, at Elder Services. Well, Joyce and I, you know, are I once was the coordinator for the Tisbury Council on Aging. So we have both. We're both hitting 35 years.
Yes. So she knows a lot about these programs. Jackie, thank you very much. So it just gives you a sense of the tremendous variety. And actually, they really go above and beyond what other places do. I do quite a bit of work. I do nothing but this work and work in with other ASAPs, other aging services access points. This is the only one, for example, that provides assistance to people who are in these supportive day programs, people who have got in early stages of dementia, don't qualify for MassHealth, but if they qualify for their programs, they're supporting those people right now. That's the only place that I know of in Massachusetts where that happens, because they're really, really interested in helping my friends Frank and Mary stay at home. That's the goal. Now, once again, all of these folks will be available afterwards for a while in case you've got particular questions. And if we have time at the end of the presentation, we're also going to take questions. But now I'd like to introduce Sandy Cordolby. I've had her here on before. I think Sandy is just provides a unique level of service to this island in terms of dealing with geriatric care management issues. Geriatric care managers, as I say, are people who are really trying to figure out or help seniors figure out, based on in terms of dealing with medical issues and social issues and the totality of their issues, how to make it. How to be able to stay in, basically, and how to specifically be able to stay at home. So I'd like Sandy to be able to talk about some of those issues, and then I'll come back and talk about a few other things. Sandy Cordolby.
Thank you. I know most of you.
By the way, that's a great phone ring. That you
it's actually an alarm. Sorry about that. I turned the ringer off, but I forgot the alarm would still ring. Anyway. I've tamed it anyway. So I'm Sandy Cordolby. Most of you know me. I've worked with some of you here in the audience before. And I'm a registered nurse, and I have a certificate in geriatric case management. My business partner is Beth Toomey, who most of you also know. Beth was the police chief up in West Tisbury for quite a while, about 16 years, and got her master's in clinical mental health, and with a goal of working with seniors around case management. She does a lot of work with elder depression, anxiety, and addiction. So that's the two of us, and we work with partners, about 25 or 30 partners in the community that provide the care that we that is the goal of our clients. So so that's a little bit about us, and we've been doing it for almost 3 years now. So, and my background is also, I work with Hope Hospice here on the island, and I also am the nurse for the Henrietta Borough House, just as a full sort of disclosure. So what does a geriatric case manager do? A lot of times, you know, I'm meeting with some families tomorrow that just want me to go into the house and take a look at mom or dad or their spouse and make recommendations based on geriatric case management as to what will help that elder stay home longer, be more independent, be safe at home. So sometimes what we do is a comprehensive assessment of mental health and functional status. This is going really great, except your mother broke her knee and the laundry is in the basement. There's a problem. So we go, that probably doesn't take me to figure out, but anyway. So we go in and we do those kinds of things. We also sort of point out some areas. One of the most important things that we do is help you figure out what's about to happen. You kind of already know what is happening, but what's about to happen and how do we get ready for that? So that's the home safety eval. Coordination of medical appointments. I spend a lot of my day at the hospital in medical appointments with seniors. Perhaps the family member or the daughter lives in Ohio and mom's going to the doctor and she wants to make sure that somebody gets a grip on what medications that mom is supposed to be taking. Statistically, somebody over the age of 70 takes the medications that are ordered by their physician with 19% accuracy. 19%. And Basil, you can help me with this one. The average senior over the age of 70 in the United States is taking 14 medications. Am I in there? I think I'm in there. So that's a whole lot of medications to not be taking accurately. And some of them you probably need. So that's the medical oversight that we offer is myself and some of our other nurses that work with us. We'll go to the doctor and make sure that things are happening the way that they're supposed to be happening at home. Mental health counseling for the elder as well as their family. You know, the elder's not in this alone and neither is the family. So there's an awful lot of times that we just have to help that out-of-town daughter figure out what's going on and what's going to happen next. As I said, a lot of what we do is getting ready for what's going to happen next. So healthcare proxies, powers of attorney, setting up trusts, and things like that. Arthur and I had 5 clients together today to do just that. Somebody here in the audience asked me, do I need a power of attorney?
The answer is yes.
A power of attorney. Right. Everybody needs a power of attorney. If something happens quickly, you want somebody to be able to keep paying the bills or pay the mortgage or pay the water bill or or if something happens quickly, you want somebody that you trust to be making decisions for you, that knows you and your family and the choices that you've made. I won't go on and on about it, but healthcare proxies are my favorite thing to talk about. Healthcare proxies, you know, automatically, how many times I end up in the emergency room or the ICU with a family member and mom is looking like she's getting to the end of her life and somebody needs to make some decisions and we look at the healthcare proxy and it's dad. And he died 2 years ago. Oops. Or he's got a little bit of dementia coming on and he really shouldn't be making those decisions or he's too emotional right now. So I love to talk to folks and counsel folks about who really should be the healthcare proxy, and do they know what you really want so that it happens the way that you want it to happen. Coordination of outside services. So I'm kind of the funnel or the quarterback of all of this. Jackie's office and I are on the phone. I wish I could tell you it's daily. It's probably 5 times a day. I mean, most of the clients, I have about 73 clients that we're working with right now, and I think probably better than 75% of them we have hooked up with Jackie's programs. The Councils on Aging, amazing programs these guys have, but who knows all the programs? Who can remember everything that Jackie just said? Or who knows all the programs that not only Elder Services offers, but each one of the Councils on Aging are very unique and offer different kinds of programs. And anybody can go to any of those programs. And what about the Parkinson's Association? Beth and I actually made a presentation to the Parkinson's Support Group last Monday, and what an amazing group. At first I thought that they didn't like what I was saying, and then I realized they have Parkinson's. They can't really show me in their face. But anyway, it went pretty well. And there's lots of support groups. The Memory Cafe didn't come up, but the Memory Cafe, what a wonderful program that is. And go, even if you're not having memory problems yet, they have the greatest music. And you know, they're singing all these old songs that you guys would all love. So it's a great program. It's at, help me here, it's at Featherstone on Wednesdays.
Yes.
And what time?
9 to 9.
9-ish. And then it's at the Hillside right now on Thursdays from 10 to 12. What a fantastic program that is.
Just moved to Featherstone.
Oh, did they? I knew they were about to. So now they're both at Featherstone. Wednesdays, thank you for that, Wednesdays and Thursdays. Facilitation of information between the elders and their families and the medical teams. Because we live on Martha's Vineyard, you all have more than one doctor. There's specialists, some of the specialists come here. If you have Parkinson's, you don't have a specialist here because there's no neurologist here. There's lots of coordination to be done. And often, more often than I'd like to think, actually, I go in to help an elder figure out their medications, and I realize that Dr. A up at Mass General ordered something that Dr. Larson over at Martha's Vineyard Hospital didn't know about, and they should not be taken together. Somebody's making their heart go faster, somebody's making their heart go slower. This is not good. So, you know, coordination of information between the elders, between the medical team, and also so many of our elders have family members that are off island. They really want to know. I have a lady over in the emergency room today, and I've been texting back and forth with her kids. One of them is in California, one of them is in Ohio, and one of them is in Washington, D.C. So everybody all over the map knows exactly what's happening with mom today and whether or not her head CAT scan has come out normal. Or they will know that as soon as I do. So if anybody thinks that I might be able to help, we would be more than happy to. I put brochures on your table. I completely subscribe to what Joyce and Jackie have both said, which is don't wait till it's a crisis. You know, I've had phone calls from many elders that said, you know, I'm 89. I didn't think I was gonna live this long. I'm gonna run out of money. There's nothing wrong with me. What do I do? So those are the kinds of things that we can help you with before the crisis comes. Most of my phone calls are from the hospital saying that, you know, Sylvia's in the hospital and wants to go home tomorrow and needs services, whether it's an hour, day, or somebody to live in. We can probably get that to happen, maybe not by the morning, but maybe by the next morning. So if we can help you now, we are always happy to just sit and have a conversation, just as community friends, about what the programs are and what we do, and then you can decide if you think that we can help you after that.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
So I just wanted to mention, it was actually Sandy that convinced me to rethink the way I thought about healthcare proxies. Because I had always, healthcare proxies, you say, oh, well, you know, I want my husband or my wife to be my proxy, and then if they can't do it, well, then I'm gonna have one of the kids. But Sandy really kind of introduced me to this notion. She said, well, you know, you get to be a certain age, and you say to yourself, if my wife is in the hospital sick, what do I really want to be doing? Do I want to be talking to the doctor and going through the medical records? Or do I want to be with my wife who's in the hospital sick, you know? And if I've got, at that point, one of those classic, typically it's a daughter, a designated daughter, who is the one who's always going to be responsible for all this stuff anyway, why don't I just name her as the proxy so she can deal with the doctor and figure out the medical records, and I can be with my wife or with my husband. So it really just kind of maybe kind of stop or think about this differently. So I just want to mention a couple of things. So once again, that's Frank and Mary, that's their asset situation. And that's their income situation. So if that's Frank and Mary's income, now I was just talking to Jackie on the side because we were talking about all of the services that Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands can provide, and that adds up, can add up to potentially a lot of money, like in the $600-$700 a week type, in terms of what they're paying for those services, right? $600-$700 a week, or like $2,500 a month, you know, around it in services. Sometimes there's a copay for those services. The copay for Frank and Mary, given the income that I just gave you, was 101. You can't see this chart, it's way too small. I made it on purpose so you couldn't see it. No, but it's like $100 a month or $101 a month for this amazing package of services. So don't, first of all, don't, well, you can call Jackie if it's an emergency, but try not to. I mean, you know, the best time to do this is if you were getting older and you want to have some sense of whether there are some things they can do, just call them. You know, have them talk to somebody over the phone, maybe have them, somebody come out to your house to talk to you about kind of what your needs may be, so you can get a sense of all this. So I'm just going to talk about a couple of things about what you might want. These are the only documents as an elder that you really, really, really need to have, right? I mean, you may want to talk about a will, you may want to talk about a trust or stuff regarding your kids, but at that point, you're going to be dead. You know, you don't want to worry about those too much. These are important to you while you're alive. Excuse me. Your healthcare proxy, the MOLST form. Raise your hand if you know what MOLST stands for. Oh, that's something that I can teach you. And the power of attorney, the ones that we were just talking about. Very briefly, power, healthcare proxy, very easy to do. You need two witnesses. Doesn't have to be notarized, right? The person you're naming as the proxy can make all your medical decisions for you, but only if your doctor says that you're incapable of doing it yourself, and your doctor says that in writing. And as soon as your doctor says you're better, the proxy stops, right? The proxy can be revoked at any time by you, even if you've given this proxy. And by the way, the only challenge, I always hear people saying, well, if I give somebody my proxy, are they going to be able to put me in the nursing home? Well, interestingly, the answer is no. The answer is no, because the way the law is written, the proxy law is written, you can revoke the proxy at any time, even if your doctor says you're nuts, right? So if you get to the nursing home and your daughter has said it's time for Mom to go, right? And you're there, and you say to the nursing home, I don't want to be here, I don't want to go. Well, actually, the nursing home is supposed to say, okay, you go back home. And unless there's a court order saying that you go to the nursing home, you don't, right? There's actually a case on this. Somebody was getting admitted to McLean's, actually, and didn't want to be. And the case went up, and the Supreme Court said, hey, that your refusal to go to say your refusal to go to the nursing home amounted to a revocation of the proxy. Just a piece of trivia: when you die, your proxy, you should know, has the ability to give your remains to the donor, to the organ bank. So if you don't want that to happen, you probably want to put that right in your proxy. Most people don't realize this. Your proxy only has control of your remains for purposes of this, not for purposes of cremating you or doing whatever else with the remains. The MOLST is what used to be called the DNR, but you all know what a DNR is, right? So this was what the Department of Public Health did to kind of supersede the DNR. They said, we'd like you to consider ahead of time a set of decisions and talk to those with your doctor, and talk to those with your doc, about those with your doctor. First, should I be resuscitated? What's that mean, really? It means if my heart has stopped, should someone try to start it again? A very painful process. It means pushing really hard through your ribs, probably breaking a lot of them, to try to get your heart to start going again. The likelihood of survival, I think I heard from, remember when we did the presentation? I thought the likelihood, if you were like over 80 years old, of living more than 30 days, if you got it, was like 5%. It's like 25% that you're going to get resuscitated then, but you're not going to make it for very long after that. So you really want to consider that. You also want to consider some other decisions like intubation. If you stop breathing, do you really want someone to push a tube down your throat into your lungs and push some air in it to start getting going again? There are a set of decisions like that that are all in the MOLST form. MOLST stands for Medical Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment, right? One of the most important ones is, if you're at home and any of this has happened, do you really want to go to the hospital, right? If your goal was to die at home, do you really want to go to the hospital? If the you can say right in your MOLS form, if the guy from the ambulance shows up, don't bring me to the hospital, right? Which may be exactly what you want. So a couple of things about the MOLS form. Technically, the MOLS form is a doctor's form. It is a doctor's order to all of these other people down the medical food chain, nurses and EMTs and stuff, that says, this is what you're supposed to do. You would sign an assent to it, but it's your doctor who actually signs the form, right? Keep it on the refrigerator. Why? Because all of the ambulance guys have been trained, that's how their protocol works. You get to the house, you go in, you see somebody on the floor, look at the refrigerator. There's no MOLS form, if there's no form on the refrigerator, stop looking, because you got a lot to do. You know, person's on the ground, right? So if you want it to be effective, put it on the refrigerator. Finally, remember this, your proxy can always overrule every medical decision you have made, no matter what. So-called living wills, advanced directives, all legally unenforceable in Massachusetts, but even your MOLS form, if in the form you say, do not resuscitate me, and your daughter, the proxy, is next to you and you're on the floor and she's saying, I want my mother resuscitated, they're going to resuscitate you. So you want to know that you can trust your proxy to do what you want, okay? And that's why you want to do the healthcare proxy, because you don't want to have to anybody to have to go to court to figure out who's going to make these medical decisions for you. Power of attorney, just very quickly, you should have a power of attorney. That's the other form you have to have, so that if you're incapacitated, somebody can sign for you. Does not have to be witnessed, does not have to be notarized, but you probably want to have it notarized. Why is that? I've used this line before, but many people have heard it. My daughter once gave me a T-shirt that said, the good lawyer knows the law, the great lawyer knows the judge. Now, in this case, the judge is not like a real judge who would know that you don't need to have the thing notarized. It's like the bank teller, you know, or your insurance agent. So you need to walk in with something that looks really official, right? Even though it doesn't have to be, so always have it notarized, just so that it'll look official. I know that sounds stupid coming from a lawyer, but that's why you do it. On notaries, as opposed to your proxy, where you can only name one person at a time, notaries, you can name two people jointly and severally. So in that situation, that Frank and Mary? On power of attorney, you can name two people jointly and severally. Thank you. So for example, in that situation where you've got Frank and Mary who are getting older, and really they want to say, they don't want to deal with the health stuff. So maybe what they each want to do is name their spouse and that designated daughter jointly and severally, so that either one of them can take care of their medical decisions for them if one of them is incapacitated. A couple of other things. So in that Frank and Mary situation, what you don't have to do if you're Frank and Mary in the asset situation I gave you is transfer all your assets, give them away, put them in an irrevocable trust, and wait 5 years. We've talked about this before, so I'm not going to go into detail. You don't have to do that, because you can wait till the last minute. If Mary or Frank needs nursing home care, you can simply shift all the assets to the other spouse and have that other spouse buy an annuity, and then the person in the nursing home can qualify. So you don't have to lose control of any of your assets. I'm not going to go through that, because I'm just getting late. The only time you do have to be sensitive to that is if Frank is already dead, Mary owns all the assets, and then she needs nursing home care. She's going to have a problem. She's going to have to spend on all of this money down to $2,000, and then they're going to put a lien on the house. Except in one case, and so that's what I'm going to leave you with. Many people have these like old long-term care insurance policies. And they're little. They got to pay very, very little money. And they'll pay for a nursing home like $50, $60 a day for a couple of years. And so why should you keep them? Well, the reason is to protect that house. If you have a policy that was issued before March 15th, 1999, and it says in it that if you go to a nursing home, that the policy will pay at least $50 a day, $50 a day for 730 days, which is 2 years, and if you go directly from home to the nursing home, and if at the time you go to the nursing home, and this is where the law just changed, there is at least 1 day left on that policy, 1 day left, right? Then, and if you say on your application that you don't intend to return home, this is a lot to remember, so you want to call your lawyer to make sure you get this part right. If you say that, the home is safe. Home doesn't count as an asset. Home can't be liened. And following your death, there's no claim against the estate for the home. It's completely safe. If the policy is dated after March 15th, from March 15th, 1999 to today, then the policy has to pay at least $125 a day for at least 730 days or 2 years, right? And once again, same rules. You have to go directly from home to the nursing home. There has to be at least 1 day left on the policy. And you have to say in your application that you don't want to return home. So once again, this presentation is designed, well, for some of you who are here, who are a little over 70, but also for younger people who are just kind of retiring. If you're on Martha's Vineyard and you're worried that you might be stuck in this situation, your husband's dead or your wife's dead, and you're wanting to protect the house, this doesn't protect anything but the house, but it protects the house no matter what it's worth, right? You may want to go buy yourself one of these policies. I'm not a big fan of long-term care insurance in general, right? But for places like here where houses are so valuable, right? If you can buy this, and the premium is going to cost you something. And by the way, you know who should be paying the premium for this? Your kids. Because you're not doing this for you, right? In this situation, your husband's dead. You're in the nursing home. You don't care. You're in the nursing home. You're not going back home. You said you're not going home, right? This is to protect the Martha's Vineyard house that your kids have always said, oh, please, Ma, don't sell the house. We really want the house. Well, tell them to buy the stupid insurance, right? And they can have the house, right? So I just make that as an observation. If you have any other questions about any of this, Frank and Mary have their own YouTube channel. That's it. Elder Law Frank and Mary, or the Martha's Vineyard Cable, I am told, plays these shows a lot. So you can see it there. If you've got any questions, you know, I always give advice for free. I love giving advice, as you can tell. So thank you very much. And once again, the goal of the exercise, as you all know, if you've come to these, is to sleep well at night. You know, you get to a certain age and fame and fortune are irrelevant. The question is, can you get a good night's sleep? So thank you very much. Any questions from any of our folks here? They're all going to stay for a few minutes afterwards in case you have questions that would rather not be on camera. But any questions? Any questions? Yes, ma'am, and then you, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Unfortunately, my husband and I are seniors and we don't have any children. So in that case, and all our friends are our age or older.
So you're seniors, you don't have any children, and your lawyer has said that you should leave everything to him?
No.
That would be my recommendation.
Who do you find to do healthcare proxy and power of attorney?
Who do you find to do healthcare proxy
and power of attorney? Who wants to do it?
Who wants to? That is a great question. There is no great answer to that. You know, good friends?
They don't want it.
They don't want it because they're all afraid of that.
Yes.
They're all afraid. I can't give you a good answer to that. That's the hardest thing, either that you don't have children or that you don't have any children that you trust.
So a lawyer wouldn't be a good idea.
Oh, no. I've done that. I've done the power of attorney one. I'm always nervous about healthcare proxy, but then I'd want you to tell me, and I'd want to keep in my records, something pretty clear about what you want those medical decisions to be. Because, you know, I don't kind of know you, right? But, yes, lawyers will do both of those.
Doctors wouldn't.
No, your doctor won't do it. Doctor would be in a conflict situation if he did it. You want that kind of third party, right? Sorry, I can't give you a better one. Yes, ma'am.
My question was to Sandy.
Do you want to be someone's healthcare proxy or power of attorney?
I'm taken.
Okay, you can charge as much as her lawyer would charge.
We'll talk about it. My question was to Sandy. I don't fully understand, is the geriatric care management Horizons a part of Elderly Service?
No, we're an independent company.
Yourself.
Oh. We're an independent company. We're that sort of quarterback for all the services that are available on the island. It's our job to understand all the different services, whether they're state, local, or federally funded, to hook you up with everything that we can think of that you could need.
That's right. And the bad news is that a lot of the work that she does, a portion of the work that she does, is not insured, right? Except that that's the best uninsured dollar that you're ever going to spend, is the dollar that you spend figuring out how to make all the other stuff work, including getting the insurance. You know, so I think you want to think about that. Okay. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. Last question, and then we're done.
A little clarification on power of attorney and healthcare proxy. We have healthcare proxy with daughter designated.
Yeah.
Separately, we have a power of attorney who is our son.
Yeah.
Do we need a Do we need to have a power of attorney specifically for healthcare issues, or is the proxy?
So your question is, you've got a healthcare proxy naming your daughter and a power of attorney naming your son. Not an uncommon combination. But your question is, do you need a special power of attorney to deal with healthcare?
Yes.
The healthcare proxy deals with all healthcare issues.
Okay.
The power of attorney deals with everything else.
Okay.
That gave your son the power to make every decision for you,
yes,
except the healthcare decision. So you got it exactly right. Exactly right. Thank you very, very much for coming. We look forward to seeing you in a couple of months. And thank you very much. Can I have a round of applause for my wonderful guests? And thanks a million, Jackie. Really. And, you know, she's always inviting me, but she never gets to talk about what she does, which is a lot.
Joyce.
So thanks a million, Joyce. Did I say Jackie?
Yeah.
Am I getting old? Yes. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.